Welcome to the Intro to Networks version 7 for the Cisco Networking Academy. This is Module 15, Application Layer. In Module 15, we're going to look at application, presentation, and session, peer-to-peer, web and email protocols, IP addressing services, and file sharing services. Let's take a look first at the application, presentation, and session. The application layer, the upper three layers of the OSI model, application, presentation, and session, define functions of the TCP/IP application layer. So if we look over here at the TCP/IP model, these, as they compare to the OSI model, the session, presentation, and application, in the TCP/IP model, they've all been collapsed into one layer. The application layer provides the interface between the applications used to communicate and the underlying network over which the messages are transmitted. Some of the most widely known application layer protocols include HTTP, FTP, TFTP, IMAP, and DNS. The presentation and session layer, they have three primary functions: formatting or presenting data at the source device into a compatible format for receipt by the destination device, compressing data in a way that can be decompressed by the destination service, and encrypting data for transmission and decrypting data upon receipt. The session layer functions. It creates and maintains dialogue between the source and destination applications, and it handles the exchange of information to initiate dialogues, keeps them active, and to restart sessions that are disrupted or if they're idle for a long period of time. The TCP/IP application protocols specify the format and control information necessary for many common internet communication functions. The application layer protocols are used by both the source and destination services, or devices, excuse me, during a communication session. And for the communications to be successful, the application layer protocols that are implemented on the source and destination host must be compatible. So for example here, DNS domain name system uses TCP and UDP client 53, translates domain names such as Cisco into IP addresses. DHCP, or dynamic host configuration protocol, is UDP client 68 and server 67. And then web is HTTP. You have TCP 80 or 8080. And then you have the 443, which is the encrypted HTTP protocol. Peer-to-peer. The client-server model, client and server processes are considered to be in the application layer. In the client-server model, the device requesting the information is called a client, and the device responding to the request is called a server. It's not in our traditional way that we think of servers and clients. So we have like a web server. Think about it a little bit differently, that whatever's requesting is the client and whatever's delivering the information is the server in this case. So application layer protocols describe the format of the request and responses between the client and servers. In a peer-to-peer network, two or more computers are connected via a network and can share resources such as printers and files without having a dedicated server. Every connected end device, known as a peer, can function as both a server and a client. One computer might assume the role of a server for one transaction while simultaneously serving as a client for another. The roles of client and server are set on a per-request basis. So for example, this computer here, which is peer 2, can have a printer attached to it, and this computer over here can send a print request to it. And this is acting as the client, this is acting as the print server, and it sends the information and it sends it, then peer 2 sends it to the printer. A peer-to-peer application allows a device to act as both a client and a server within the same communication. Some P2P applications use a hybrid system where each peer accesses an index server to get the location of a resource stored on another peer. Common P2P applications, BitTorrent, Direct Connect, eDonkey, Freenet, some of the file sharing networks, they can run software that they don't have to have a server. So this computer here can say, where is my song.mp3? And then it can go out on the internet or on a network and say, I've got a piece of it, I've got a piece of it, and I've got a piece of it. And then it can construct it off of those different pieces. Web and email protocols. Hypertext Transfer Protocol and Hypertext Markup Language When a web address or uniform resource locator, URL, is typed into a web address, the web browser establishes a connection to the web service. The web service is running on the server that is using the HTTP protocol. To better understand how the web browser and service is interact, examine below how a web page is open in a browser. So the browser interprets the three parts of the URL. It looks to see HTTP, that's the protocol. Most browsers these days, you don't have to type in HTTP though, it will convert that for you. Then you have the www.cisco.com, which is the server name, and then you have the specific file name, in this case, index.html. In most cases, we don't have to put in the index.html. The server just says, if you don't have an index.html there, we're gonna serve up the default page, which is, in this case, index.html. So you would put in http www.cisco.com/index.html. The server then selects that page of information and sends it to you. Step two, the browser then checks with the name server to convert Cisco into a numeric IP address, which it uses to connect to the server. The client initiates an HTTP request to a server by sending a GET request to the server and asks for the index.html file. In step three, the response to the server sends the HTML code for this web page to the browser. So it takes the index.html file and code, and it sends it and reconstructs it on the browser on the client side. And then in step four, the browser deciphers the HTML code and formats the page for the browser window based on the code that it received. HTTP and HTTPS. HTTP is a request response protocol that specifies the message types used for that communication. The three common messages are GET, POST, and PUT. GET is a client request for data. A client web browser sends a GET message to the web server. POST, this uploads data files to the web server such as form data. And PUT, this uploads resources or content to the web server such as an image. Email protocols. Email is a store and forward method of sending, storing, and receiving electronic messages across a network. Email messages are stored in databases on mail servers, and email clients communicate with the mail servers to send and receive that mail. So email protocols are used in operation for either SMTP or POP or IMAP. SMTP is Simple Mail Transfer Protocol. Post Office Protocol or POP and IMAP are used for clients to receive mail. When a client sends email, the client SMTP process connects with a server SMTP process on a well-known port 25. After the connection is made, the client attempts to send the email to the server across the connection. And when the server receives the message, it either places the message in a local account, if the recipient is local, or it forwards the message to another mail server for delivery. The destination email server may not be online or may be busy. If so, the SMTP spools messages to be sent at a later date. And SMTP messages formats require a message header, recipient email address, and a sender email address, and a message body. So three parts to it. POP is used by an application to retrieve mail from a mail server. When mail is downloaded from the server to the client using POP message, they are then deleted on the server. So that's the big distinction here. POP deletes the messages after it reads them. So the server starts the POP service by passively listening to TCP port 110. When the server responds, or when a client wants to make use of the service, it sends a request to establish a TCP connection. The connection is established, the POP server sends a greeting, the client and the POP server then exchange commands and responses, and the email gets downloaded and it gets deleted off the server. POP does not store messages, so it's not recommended for small businesses that need a centralized backup solution. IMAP is another protocol that describes a method to retrieve email. Unlike POP, when a user connects to an IMAP server, copies of the message are downloaded to the client application, but the original messages are kept on the server until manually deleted. So when a user decides to delete messages, the server synchronizes that action and deletes the message from the server. So it'll leave it on the server until you delete it on your client. And when you delete it on your client, it will send a message back up to the server to say, hey, it's okay to go ahead and delete that now, or move it to the trash can. IP addressing services. Domain name service. Domain names were created to convert numeric IP addresses into simple, recognizable names, like Cisco.com. Fully qualified domain names are FQDNs, such as http://www.cisco.com are much easier for people to remember than 198.132.219.25. Think about it the same way you remember phone numbers. If we could just say, hey, call up Joe Smith in New York, and you in your phone. Now we can do that, of course, now with smartphones. But think about that with just the regular phone, and you don't even need to know the telephone number. The telephone number gets registered into the system, and you just tell it where you want it, you know, who do you want to call, and it would just convert it for you. That's what DNS does for you. The DNS protocol defines an automated service that matches resource names with the required numeric address, network address. It includes the format for queries, responses, and data. So what happens is when you create a fully qualified domain name, it gets registered on the domain name service, and then those get propagated through the internet. So then all the DNS servers have the same copies of information. So sometimes it can take 48 to 72 hours for a new domain with a new IP address to get uploaded and moved across the internet. But once it is there and then the DNS services get updated, you can just put in the domain name and it gets converted to the IP address. The DNS message format. The DNS server stores different types of resource records that are used to resolve names. Some of those types of records are A for an end device IPv4 address, NS, an authoritative name server, and AAAA, an end device IPv6 address, pronounced quad A, or MX, a mail exchange record. When a client makes a query, the DNS server processes, first looks at its own records to resolve the name. If it's unable to resolve the name by using its stored records, it contacts the other services to resolve the name. And after a match is found and returned to the original requesting server, the server temporarily stores the numbered address in the event that the same name is requested again. And some larger companies will maintain DNS servers internally so that those DNS requests are handled internally and cuts down some of the network traffic through their ISP. DNS uses the same message format between servers consisting of a question, answer, authority, and additional information. So you got a question, the name for service, the answer, authority, who's got the authority for that, and then the resource records holding additional information. The hierarchy, DNS uses a hierarchical system to create a database to provide name resolution. Each DNS server maintains a specific database file, and it's only responsible for managing name to IP mappings for that small portion of the entire DNS structure. When a DNS server receives a request for the name translation that is not within its DNS zone, the DNS server forwards the request to another DNS server within the proper zone for translation. So an example of that would be a .com, a .org, a .us, a .au, .co. A second level domain would be a cisco.com, and then, you know, cisco.com or ftp.cisco or mail.cisco.com. The NS lookup command allows you to see what default server and IP address. So an NS lookup is a computer operating system utility that allows a user to manually query DNS servers configured on the device to resolve a given host name. The utility can also be used to troubleshoot name resolution issues and to verify current status of the name servers. When the NS lookup command is issued, the default DNS server configured for your host is displayed, and the name of a host or domain can be entered into the NS lookup prompt. So here you can see we did an NS lookup. The default server was dns-sj.cisco.com, and it will return the IP address for us. Or we can just put in cisco.com, and then it will give us the server and the address name, the origin, and the v6. Dynamic Host Configuration Protocol, or DHCP. For V4 service, it's automated the assignment of V4 addresses, subnet mask and gateways, and other V4 networking diameter parameters. DHCP is considered dynamic addressing compared to static IP addressing. Static addressing is manually entered IP addresses on each client, where dynamic, you set a pool on your server and it will pass those out. When a host connects to the network, the DHCP server is contacted and an address is requested. The DHCP server chooses an address from a configured range or pool, and then it gives out an IP, it gives out that IP address and a lease time. Many networks use both DHCP and static addressing. So DHCP is used for generic purpose hosts such as end devices. Static addressing is used for network devices such as a gateway router, a switch, a server, or a printer. DHCP operations. When V4 DHCP configured device boots up or connects to the network, the client broadcasts a DHCP discover message to identify any available DHCP servers. If a server is found, it replies with the information. The client sends a DHCP request then that says, hey, I need an IP address. The server then returns a DHCP acknowledgement, acknowledging the client that the lease has been finalized. And if the offer is no longer valid, then the selected server responds with a DHCP negative acknowledgement, and the process must begin with the DHCP discover again. Also, just a quick note here, DHCP, after a certain amount of time on its lease, the DHCP client will send a request to say, hey, you know, can I still have this IP address? And if the server's available, then it will send a request and it will renew the lease. File sharing services. File transport protocol, or FTP, was developed to allow for data transfers between a client and a server. An FTP client is an application which runs on a computer that's being used to push and pull data from an FTP server. Step one is the client establishes a connection on TCP port 21. The client establishes a second connection to the server for the actual data transfer using TCP port 20, and then the data transfer happens, and it's a push-pull. Server message block, or SMB, is a client-server request-response file-sharing protocol. There's three functions of SMB messages. It starts, authenticates, and terminates sessions, control file and printer access, and allows an application to send or receive messages to or from another device. And unlike the file sharing supported by FTP, clients establish a long-term connection to the servers, and after the connection is established, the user or the client can access the resources on the server as though the resource is local to the client host. Okay, so what did we cover in this session? We looked at HTTP messages, GET, POST, PUT. We looked at peer-to-peer networking. We looked at the client-server model. We looked at DNS, DHCP, FTP client, and the functions of SMB. I hope this information was helpful for you. Be safe and be excellent to each other.